It's great to have everybody here today. And I know over the next 2 minutes, we'll have a variety of folks jumping in and joining us, but I'm going to go ahead and get us started here because I want to make the very best use of our time today. I'm pretty sure I know everybody, but if not, my name's Tom Ricks, and I'm the leader of the National Church Planting Team for our denomination. This is our fourth Zoom conversation since September, since we weren't able to have a fall retreat this year. We're thankful for the technology that allows us to get together. We've had some wonderful Zoom interactions and conversations, and this one we kind of feel like is icing on the cake. So in just a minute, I'm going to turn our time over to Carey Nieuwhof, who has been gracious enough to accept our invitation and join us. And so we're very excited about what he's going to share with us today. I want to lay out just a little bit of how we're going to do things today. It's a little bit different because we've invited a little bit larger audience. We have some non-church planters from around the denomination who are sitting in on our conversation today. And if you're not a church planter, but you've joined us for this, we're very happy to have you. And we're thankful that we know you care about church planting. I see some names and some faces popping up here. I see Dave Swanson from First Orlando, who's been a huge supporter of church planting in the EPC. So we're glad to have you guys join us. The schedule is going to be like this. In about 2 minutes, I'm going to be done with the instructions. I'm going to immediately turn it over to Carey, and he's going to share for about 40 minutes or so. And when he finishes that presentation, we're going to move immediately to a Q&A. The way you can send in a question to Q&A is twofold. First, you have to be a church planter. So while we're happy to have our larger EPC congregation with us, thank you, Brother Boone. I see the amen from your end. We want to ask that if you're not a church planter, that you hold off on asking any questions, because this is fundamentally to resource our church planters. And Mike Moses, I know you think you're still a church planter, but not quite. So active church planters, what you're going to do is you're going to go into the chat and you're going to send your question to Sean Robinson. Scroll down and find Sean and just send him the question at any time in the next 40 minutes. Send that question in and he will organize those. And then when Carey says, hey, I'm ready for Q&A, we'll be able to dive right in. Should we get through those and have a few minutes left, we have a hard stop at 1:30 Central Time. If we get through those and we still have 5 or 10 minutes, then we're going to open it up to anybody. So any of the pastors, any of the folks, I see a lot of different ministry leaders just here on screen one, then we'll open it up to anybody and everybody to toss in a question. But at 1:30 my time, 1:30 Central Time, we will have a hard stop. Okay. So I think I've given the right instructions. I think I've covered everything on my list. So I'm going to, we had a chance to say hello to Carey a couple minutes ago when he joined us, but Carey, thanks again for being with us. So we are thrilled to have you and it's all yours, brother.
Hey, thanks so much, Tom. It's really good to meet you. I think most of us are meeting for the first time, but yeah, what a world we live in. So just so you know, I'll get this elephant out of the room right away. I have a broken hand. So that's, you're like, what is wrong with his hand? So you don't spend the whole talk thinking, what is wrong with that man's hand? I broke my thumb in a skiing accident about a month ago. So wish it was glorious, like, you know, Swiss Alps and, you know, doing moguls, but nope, I was cross country skiing going about 1 mile an hour and like just fell and it really hurt. And I said to my wife, I'm like, I think I just broke my thumb. And she's like, well, we should go to the hospital. I'm like, nah. And so I skied on it for an hour, which probably didn't help. And then went to the hospital later when I kind of noticed that there was bone where there wasn't supposed to be bone. When I finally had a look at it when we were done. So anyway, they had some surgery on it and this apparently comes off this Thursday. So we'll see how that goes. But hey, it's really good to be with you. And Tom gave me the carte blanche to talk about what I wanted to talk about. And I thought, because we are really building into church planters, and for those of you who aren't, we're kind of all church planters now as we reopen and as we rethink everything, we're moving into a brand new era. I want to talk about trends because trends really depend on strategy. So I'm a church planter. I'm also a church transitioner. There's almost nothing we haven't tried in the last 25 years of ministry. So I always say I'm from Toronto. If you listen to my podcast, I was quite excited today because I had Seth Godin on. If you follow Seth Godin's work, Seth actually knows where I live. Nobody knows where I live, but Seth has spent his whole life traveling north of here to Algonquin Park. He knows the arena that my kids grew up in. So we're actually an hour north of Toronto in a place called Oro Medonte. And I came into ministry through sort of a backwards route, did a bunch of stuff. I did radio, I did publishing, kind of. I wrote for papers and then went into history, thought I'd teach, went to law school, thought I'd practice law, and then felt a call into ministry. And really didn't think I had the pastoral gifts for ministry. So in 1995, while I was still in seminary, we decided to try out a little tiny church to see if it would work. It was actually a three-point charge. You guys would know exactly what that is. And it basically meant they banded together because they had no money and couldn't afford a pastor of their own, and they were small. So we started with, I would do the circuit on Sunday morning, and the average church size was like six at the smallest and 14 at the mid-sized church, and the mega church had an average attendance of 23 in 1995. And they were on life support. Like if it didn't work with this student from Knox College, that was going to be the end of them because they had no money. I mean, the budget for Guthrie Church was $4,000 my first year for the entire year. And by the grace of God, we started to grow. And within 5 years, we had grown enough that we were outgrowing some of the buildings. So we amalgamated, became one church, we united. We then moved to an elementary school. We went from one to three services. Then we built a building. And this was all under the guise of the Presbyterian Church in Canada. And then for a variety of reasons, we can get into if you want, but I don't think it's really that relevant, decided to start over again independently. Tried to buy the building. That did not go well with the denomination. So anyway, we started over again as Connexus Church, a North Point strategic partner in 2007. So that was really like a plant. So we took some, we had a 96% vote in favor of people who said, yeah, we're willing to give up the building. And then I think in the end, about 32% of those people came with us because they love the building more than they love the mission. And started over again, planted Connexus. So I was the lead pastor there from 2007 to 2015. And then 5 years ago, moved into a founding teaching pastor role. And then last year pivoted off staff. I do a little bit of coaching on Thursday mornings for some of the existing staff, but that's it. And part of that was I felt a new calling in my life to serve leaders, but some of that was just, you know, kind of almost paranoia about succession. It's handled so poorly in the church and so poorly in business. And this had grown way bigger than I ever thought. So I just decided I'm going to go early. I was 50 when I handed things off. And, you know, here we are all these years later. So the good news is, you know, that little handful of people has grown into when pre-COVID, 1,500 people on average today over three locations plus online. And since COVID, who knows, but, you know, it's crazy. I did one message in November that had like 16,000 views the same day. Now, I don't know who those people were, where they were, but we suspect our church has grown in the last year and a half. We're about to find out. And the one constant trend in all that is we have to keep changing. We have to keep changing. If I was planning the church over again today, it would be a very different strategy than we used in 95. I mean, 30 years has gone by. I don't know about you guys, but this seems to be like a high, not just because of COVID, but like all the originals are dying. I just got another email today that a longtime attender is gone. And it makes sense. Like if the average age of the church was 65, 70 in 1995, that means they're in their 90s today. So a lot of those people that I started with aren't around anymore. And so what I wanted to focus on today is church trends. These are things that Connexus Church is grappling with, that other churches are grappling with, mega churches, micro churches, mainline churches, evangelical churches, churches independent of geography. And the world has changed dramatically, dramatically. So I'm going to do a screen share and share some slides, and then I'll pop off for the Q&A. But I think the slides are more interesting than I am. So, can someone enable screen sharing? Is that possible? Otherwise, I'll just talk. But I think things will stay a little bit close, like we'll embed in the memory. Mindy, can you enable screen sharing or someone? Yep, there we go. All set. That was fast. That was super fast. I should have indicated that before. So here's, I've got eight on my blog, but I really wanted to double click on five for our time together today. And I'll spend about 25, 30 minutes going through them and just, yeah, then bring your questions. And again, remember the questions aren't ask me anything. So if you came in here with like, hey, the one question I want to ask, that's totally cool. It doesn't have to be connected to this talk. So crisis is not just a disruptor, it's an accelerator. And we've all learned over the last year this in so many ways. I mean, whether you look at racial justice, arguably, those are some really, really tough times, but perhaps it's accelerated cause for justice at a rate that wouldn't have happened without the crisis last year. Lots of things have changed over the last year. I did a course in 2019. I released it in November 2019. It was called The High Impact Workplace. We no longer offer it, and I'll tell you why. Because I cast this vision about, hey, in the future, people are going to work from home and your younger staff want to work from home. And I know this is really hard for you guys to believe, but you know, there are virtual companies and here's how you run a virtual company. Anyway, 6 months after it was released, we pulled it off the market because it's like, this doesn't even make sense. Like everybody's working from home now. So we redid the course last summer, released it as Lead a Better Team. And now it integrates hybrid workplaces, remote workplaces, and a lot more on that. So all this stuff just got accelerated and we have seen disruption all over the place. You don't even need a global pandemic to be disrupted. Just ask the music industry, just ask the live events industry, just ask the hotel or the taxi industry. They got disrupted without a pandemic. And what happened now, particularly the longer this goes, the more disruption is true. There's an estimate in Toronto, a city I love and lived in for a decade, that 50% of the restaurants aren't coming back after the pandemic. And you look at commercial real estate, you look at online shopping, you look at Amazon, you look at Zoom. Who bought Zoom shares a year ago? Should have, right? Crisis is an accelerator. And for too many pastors, and I think we all got caught in the headlights, losing access to a building, which is for the first time in our lifetime happened. It felt like it was losing access to ministry. I spent a couple hours yesterday with Rick Warren from Saddleback. And I asked him this question and I just said, hey, Rick, you know, what about that? And he goes, listen, he says, we, you know, classic Rick. He says, we've been purpose driven for 35 years, 40 years. He says, so we had five other things we could do. Worship wasn't everything, but for a lot of us, it felt like it was. And we were caught like a deer in the headlights. He said, discipleship didn't change. Evangelism didn't change. Community didn't change. But, you know, if you're relying on a 1 hour service on Sunday, it kind of felt like losing access to ministry. Too many church leaders claimed that the church never closed, but they behaved like it did. And it's really interesting now that we're in the reopening phase, and there are a number of churches who, like us, haven't met in almost a year in person, but they're saying, okay, now it's back to normal. Now we're open again. Now everything's fine. And so when you hear in your head or out loud signals like that, it's a sign that you're behaving like your church is closed if the doors are closed and you can't gather or you have to distance. So what is behind that? I think 2021 will lead the church into the post-pandemic world. Probably the vaccines are going to roll out. Probably we're going to reach some kind of herd immunity in the next 12 months. And the post-pandemic world, I think, is going to be fundamentally different than the pre-pandemic world. Like at the beginning, you know, a year ago, 10 months ago, people were asking, is it going to be a light switch? Like we just, okay, lights went off, lights are back on. Now we're back up to where we are. No, the airline industry has been disrupted. The tourism industry has been disrupted. The workplace has been disrupted. Education has been disrupted. And people's habits now are going on a year. You know, I did an interview with Craig Rochelle for my leadership podcast, and Craig said in a really, you know, telling way, he said, a buddy and I worked out 28 years every afternoon or, you know, 3 days a week, 3:30 in the afternoon. The pandemic crushed that. He said, I canceled my gym membership. And he told me this 6 months into the pandemic, but he said, 6 months into this, we're probably not working out again because now I have a home gym that's equipped. And so those patterns now are becoming a permanent part of how we live. For me, I used to fly last few years over 100,000 miles a year doing speaking. I promise you, going into the new world, I will not be doing that because I've realized Even though I had a system that worked, I wasn't tired, I knew how to do time zones, this is better. I'm a better boss, I'm a better husband, and we figured out a way to do that. So I will do selective events on the road, but probably less than 20 a year as opposed to 50 a year, and that'll just be different. So while normal is dead, normalized will emerge. And the question to ask is, what will be the normalized habits for people? I just went on a quick walk before we jumped on this call by the lake. We live near a lake. And, you know, I'm walking down a trail, we got snow, and here's what people are doing. There's a woman I was talking to, and she like moved out of the way to let me pass. Like, that never would have happened. I mean, you almost would have brushed coats before. When is that behavior going away? I don't know. Even if the government allows you to reassemble, when are people going to be feel really, really safe, like hugging each other, all that stuff? And you know what, because right now that's become a political statement, unfortunately, but you know, when will you feel personally comfortable enough to really connect with other humans? So here are five trends I've got my eye on. The majority of attenders may no longer be in the room. In the future church, the majority of attenders, I know that sounds like an oxymoron. Well, how can you attend when you're not in the room? Well, we now have the internet, and the internet was around long before COVID. But for the first time, the church went, oh, the internet. I mean, 12 months ago today, there was a debate, particularly among charismatics and some evangelicals, that online church was not of God, that really it was unfaithful, that video teaching doesn't work. And I heard that a million times because I started video teaching back in 2007. So I've had a decade of critics go, well, that's not really biblical. Then all of a sudden everybody got converted in March and suddenly it's very biblical and very godly and you know, all those things. But now we have online attendance. So the majority of attenders may no longer be in the room. Six things shifted home in the last 12 months. So I want you to think about this. Okay, think about your own patterns. If you have kids or grandkids, think about their patterns, think about your neighbors and friends. But here are the six things that shifted home: work, shopping, food, fitness, entertainment, and school. So where we are, we're in super strict lockdown because we think we may have a variant of the virus afoot. So we can't even eat at home. So date night last Friday night, called the restaurant, picked up the food. It was good dining. It wasn't like burritos, and brought it home. And, you know, this is our favorite restaurant, launched in February of 2020. Talk about a great time to launch a new business. And they've survived the first year. I wonder how much takeout for high-end dining is going to be part of their future. I talked to Chick-fil-A operators. They are adding like extra drive-through. And for the first time, they are now building Chick-fil-A's without the PlayStation, the little play structures. Why? Parents are concerned about germs. Parents are concerned about health. They can use the seats, and frankly, they'll use the square footage so that they can serve more meals through the triple drive-through. So work change, we talked about that. Shopping, I mean, I don't know about you, but the courier shows up here two or three times a day. Food, fitness, a lot of people, they went out and bought kettlebells. Pelotons are sold out for months. I tried to buy a bike trainer when I broke my hand. They're not even taking orders anymore. Like, you can't even go on a wait list because everybody's building their home gyms. Well, after you've spent hundreds or $1,000 on a home gym, are you going to reactivate your membership at the gym? Entertainment. I mean, this is the year that Warner Brothers and other major studios are releasing direct to your devices. What's going to happen to movie theaters? And we have two of our locations at Connexus in movie theaters. What's going to happen to them? Nobody really knows. And then school, right? My neighbor's a school teacher, and she's been in the classroom, out of the classroom, in the classroom, out of the classroom. So homeschooling is surging. Some of that's going to snap back, like post-pandemic, some of these trends are going to snap back. But I think it's going to be one of those moments. There's that famous picture of New York from 1903 versus 1913. And in 1903, what you see is all horses and buggies with one or two cars. And in 1913, you see all cars with one or two horses and buggies. And I think we're in that kind of a pivotal shift where the pre-COVID world will feel fundamentally different. And these patterns have shifted. How many are really going to shift back? So the real question then becomes, well, what about the church? What about the church? Here we go. Yeah, what about the church? So, you know, we've all pivoted to online for the most part. And if you're still alive today, that's probably how you did it, unless you're a church of six people, which arguably would have weathered the pandemic just fine, because everybody would say, oh, we'll be back in 3 years when things are normal again. Don't worry, we're not leaving, right? But for most of us, It's like, how is that going to go? And what is your strategy moving forward? So in-person gathering preferences reveal a 30-point gap between boomers and Gen Z. This is according to a recent Barna poll. So what you see is that boomers, 71% of boomers, which are people in their late 50s to mid 70s, want in-person gatherings exclusively for their worship. Gen Z, 41 points. It's a 30-point gap. So in other words, you know, boomers are almost twice as likely to say, forget the internet, we're going back to physical church. Gen Z is like, yeah, we'll be at physical church from time to time, but you better keep that internet thing coming because their whole lives are a slipstream between digital and physical. So you can see that here in the data, there's an awful lot. If you look at hybrid, 24% of boomers, that's this chart over here on the left stack, the furthest right, would like both. But when you get to Gen Z, it's only 37%. That goes up to 37%. Millennials, 40% want both. And that means only 13% of millennials in Gen Z and 11% of Gen X are saying, no, we're going to do primarily digital. But what they are saying is their irregular attendance is probably going to become more irregular in the future. And then 71% of boomers, who often make a lot of decisions in churches because they form your board, some principal donors, they're going, no, we want physical gatherings. So I think that can create a real gap between what church leaders want and how people behave. And so that's a danger zone. That's from Barna. In the future, the number of people participating in the mission who are not in the building on Sunday will probably surpass the number of people who are inside the building. And that's just a new reality. Now, one of the last things I did when I was lead pastor of Connexus was supervised and opened our broadcast location. So like most people who build things, we didn't have the money to do everything I wanted to do in my heart. We opened up not a huge campus, like 24,000 square feet. We didn't want to have a lot of debt going into the future. And there were a number of reasons, zoning being one of them. But I remember touring people through the building afterwards. And my joke became, because we only have 350 seats and we just turn them a number of times on a Sunday. My joke became, hey, we built a broadcast studio with a church attached. Ha, 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 ha. You know, we have kids ministry and all that. Little did I know that that would be the only thing left. And so we overinvested in audio video lighting. I think on a $3 million budget, we spent almost a third of it on audio video lighting. But that served us really well because, you know, now, if you look at our church, you'd think, oh, there's thousands of people in the room. There's not. There's like 300 people on a packed out Sunday, 350. But online, it looks fantastic. Online, it's really set up. And I knew even in 2015, I had a sneaking suspicion that the vast majority of people who would be accessing our ministry and getting baptized, you know, connecting groups would be accessing it through a screen rather than a seat. And so that's probably the new normal moving forward. So that means your church is still around. The church is still around. It just left the building. And we know theologically that should be the case anyway, right? We've been saying you're the church. The church is not the building. But I think that got really real during the pandemic. So in the post-pandemic church, your most engaged people may not be in the room. Okay. Trend number two, growing churches will shift their focus from gathering to connecting. Now watch your social media feed, okay? Because you're going to see this all over the place where people are like, come on back to church, come on back to church. If in 2021, coming to Christ means coming to your church in a set location at a set hour, you need a new strategy. And that has been church from the very beginning, all right? For centuries now, it's like, listen, this happens at 9 o'clock, 11 o'clock, you know, this location at this time, that location at that time. And if you want to access Jesus outside of those hours, you ever search your church on Google Maps? This freaks me out. I did it after I stopped being the lead pastor, but 90% of the time it tells people you're closed. You know how you're trying to go to the car wash or the grocery store, it tells you closing in 30 minutes. 90% of the time, Google Maps tells you your church is closed. It's like, we need to change that. We need to change that because if people are like, well, I got to go to a church, figure out what's going on. It's like close, close, close. Oh, but we are open for 1 hour. Like you wouldn't actually go to any store. You wouldn't patronize any store that was open for an hour a week. but that's how we behave as a church. So what'll happen in the future is that growing churches will focus less on gathering and more on connecting. So less on, hey, you need to be here at this time. And you know, the internet has made that easy because I before it was true, but now I definitely know, hey, if I'm not there at 9 o'clock, I know I can watch a live stream. I know I can listen to the podcast. I know I can catch it on YouTube later. I'll watch it on demand. I don't need to be there. And so smart leaders now are thinking, okay, we're still going to gather. We're still going to gather. People want to gather, but how can we connect people? So how can I connect you in your home? How can I connect you in your city? How can we focus on connecting rather than gathering? So the best analogy I can come up with for this is what small groups taught us in the 90s and 2000s, micro gatherings, home church, and the distributed church will teach us in the 2020s. So if you think about small groups and in the evangelical tradition, right, there was Sunday school and then there was worship. So Sunday morning was a whole commitment. You got to spend the whole morning at church. You do your class and then you go to worship, or you do worship. Then you go to your class, your Bible study. And then this innovation came along in the 90s and said, wait a minute, what if instead of building a Christian education wing with classrooms, we just connected people in people's homes? We basically Airbnb'd and Ubered Sunday school in the 90s and 2000s. And we said, we don't have to build this square footage. We can actually leverage your square footage, and away we go. So that was small groups. And now it's like, of course we do small groups. Everybody does small groups. But I think that's what's going to happen with attendance in the 2020s, because the internet is no respecter of geography. And if you study the analytics of what's been happening to your church over the last year, you probably notice you have clusters of people from all over the place. We had people from Germany, the UK, all across Canada. I got a buddy of mine in Vancouver who leads the biggest church in our country, Mark Clark from Village Church. I mean, he's opening campuses in Toronto and Halifax, because now that people are realizing I can watch anybody, they're watching Mark, and he's gathered critical mass to do church expansion during the pandemic. Rick Warren said it's the best ministry year they've had in 41 years because they went all out online and they're connecting people. They're not focused on gathering. They haven't been open in 47 weeks, but he says we baptized more people in the last 12 months than we have in the previous 41 years, any given year. So I think if you focus that way on micro gatherings, you can gather in your home church, and even the distributed church with micro campuses, I think that'll be the future. That's trend number two. Number three, some pastors will try to fill auditoriums while others will try to fulfill the mission. We know what we know. There's a saying about revolutions that those who profited most from the last regime will try the hardest to revive it. So, you know, after the Republican Revolution, if you were a monarchist, you're trying to bring that monarchy back, but that ship has sailed. And there's a lot of us who know how to fill auditoriums, and there's a lot of ego addicted to filling auditoriums. So you can try that, or you can try to fulfill the mission. So in the future, I think we'll think, hopefully, the growing churches will think a little more like Amazon, a little less like JCPenney. So the one thing that both of those organizations have in common is they have stores. If you remember, Amazon was opening Prime stores prior to the pandemic. I don't know what's going to happen post-pandemic, but most of their commerce, 99.9% of it, happens online. JCPenney was a store that had a website. And to really, really access JCPenney, it's like, no, you got to get to the mall at these set hours and away you go. Whereas if I have insomnia and I wake up at 3 a.m. and I want to order a new shirt, I just do that from Amazon. If it doesn't fit, I just send it back, right? So I think church is going to feel a little bit more like Amazon, a little less like JCPenney. And seeing digital as optional means your church will end up like malls in the age of Amazon, just hoping for people to show up again. Because remember, we had a year of habits under our belts now, and we've seen that 30-point gap between boomers and the younger generation. So if you think, well, yeah, there is the internet, and we'll kind of pay attention to that post-pandemic, but really we're going to fill this auditorium, I think that could be a losing battle. Full rooms do not guarantee a fulfilled mission. That's always been true, but I think it's especially true now. And as you know, Tony Morgan released a report in the last quarter of 2020, where the average return to church attendance for those churches that had reopened for physical gathering was 36%. Might be trending. I haven't gotten new stats, but according to the friends I talked to, it might be a little bit closer to 50% now of what your pre-COVID attendance was. But I don't know a single church leader that set out in January of 2020 to say, you know what we hope will be 36% of what we were last year, right? Or 50% of what we were last year. We all want a fulfilled mission, but that may not be dependent on a full room. If the size of your vision shrinks to the size of a room you can fill, you probably miss the church's mission. But I mean, look at your social feed. Like I said earlier, there are so many pastors right now trying to fill the room, fill the room, fill the room. Some of that is because of ego. It's like, I just like full rooms. I don't feel good about myself if every seat isn't full. And it's like, I don't know. Churches that connect people will eclipse churches that gather people. So if you just think of how can we connect people, how can we connect them in their neighborhood, in their community, I think they'll eventually eclipse churches that gather people. Now, gatherings are not going away. You're always going to have people who gather for church, but it felt like a losing battle kind of before COVID. It's really going to feel like a losing battle after COVID. So currently, and here's the paradigm shift, pastors use online to get people into the building. In the future, pastors will use the building to reach people online. So in the past, a pastor would say, hey, for those of you watching online, we need you to get in here. And you can still do that, okay? And still say, hey, if you're within 30 minutes of a campus, we want you to be here, blah, blah, blah. But I think in the future, pastors are going to realize, no, I'm in this building right now, like I'm right here, but I'm using this to reach you. And that this kind of teaching, it's a little bit better in person, but it'll do for 90 minutes online. And we can have live interaction. We can connect with each other. And so I think you'll begin to see the building really as a hub, as a broadcast studio to reach people online. And you'll have some people in the room at the same time. Number four, this is a big one. This is what I've been thinking about a lot over the last few months. Content alone won't cut it. Community and connection will. So we all scrambled to get online in March of 2020, and then we're all watching our message views, our Facebook views, our YouTube views, and it's like, oh, nobody watched or everybody watched, and sometimes those numbers are inflated and we can talk about it. And then they dropped. And then, you know, pastors said, you know what the problem is? People are screened out. People are just screened out. They're just tired of Zoom. They're tired of the internet. And I would suggest, no, people are not screened out. People are not screened out. If you think people are screened out, talk to TikTok or Instagram. They would suggest that people are not screened out. And what people are screened out of is content that isn't relevant to them. So if you've seen your numbers drop, there's probably a disconnect somewhere in the mix. You know, I've been researching Clubhouse, which is the latest app right now. It's still invite only. I'm on, but I'm not active. There are reasons for that, but like people are not screened out and the internet is growing on a regular basis. So what you need to do to compete is to make the goal of digital content connection and community, not consumption. It's pretty easy in the same way attendance used to tell us, well, you know, 100 people attended or 1,000 people attended or 10,000 people attended, made us feel good about ourselves. You can look at the share counters and the view counters, and that is feedback, okay? But if you have 16,000 views on a message and zero baptisms, you're probably not accomplishing your mission. You're just not doing it. And so what is the goal of getting your digital content online? It's not consumption, it's connection and community, that you want to get to know the people who are accessing your content. You want to get to know and connect with people in the same way that the goal was never attendance. We just want you to sit in a chair. The goal was connection and community. You want to connect people. And I'll share a little bit more on that before we're done. But number five, and this is the fifth trend, is spiritual entrepreneurs will thrive. Spiritual entrepreneurs. And you guys, for the most part, are church planters and women. You're church planters, which is amazing. Spiritual entrepreneurs see tomorrow's solutions when most leaders can only see today's problems. So these are real problems, but the obstacle is the way. And every obstacle brings with it an opportunity. And the church can be at its best when the chips are down. And so entrepreneurs, what do? They solve problems. And buildings were not an issue for the early church. It just spread door to door, house to house, person to person. And so you've got to see the solution, not the problem. Many ideas you'll see in church in 2021 will be denounced and dismissed until they're not. You'll hear, particularly when things reopen, you'll hear people saying, well, you know, online church is not really real church. And you can't really have people who don't live in your state, don't live in your town, don't live in your community. No, that isn't, what do you mean? Like on demand is not the same as a live stream. That doesn't work. And they'll be dismissed until they're not. The leaders we criticize today will be the leaders who coach us tomorrow. And some of you will be those leaders. Like you're going to try some new things and it's going to fail. Just going back to Seth Godin, I was listening to that at lunch, so it was top of mind. I asked Seth, you know, how do you know what works and what doesn't? He goes, Carey, I have failed spectacularly. He says, I can't tell you how many times I've failed. I can't tell you how many bad ideas I've had. But good ideas or bad ideas lead to good ideas. And eventually you figure out, oh, we've discovered something that sticks. Now, you know, you don't want to take the family farm and bet it on something. On the other hand, you're always experimenting on the side and you're paying attention going, oh, that really got some traction. We're connecting people. We're discipling them. We're leading people to Christ. Okay, we should pay attention to that and maybe pour more fuel on it. So I want to give you some action steps for this year and then we'll throw it open for Q&A. So those are the trends. What do you do about it? Number one, and this is just good news for everybody, regardless of your size or your budget, it's just be the local church. Just be the local church. Because one of the trends we could have talked about today is I think there's been a lot of market consolidation going on. And what you're seeing is that the growing churches are growing even more. The big churches are getting even bigger because all of a sudden, everybody who attended church went, wait a minute, on this phone, I not only get access to my church, I get access to anybody I want. And so they're like, oh, this Mike Todd guy, you know, oh, I really love Christine Kane's preaching. She's amazing. And suddenly they're not with you anymore. They're with somebody else. And that can be very threatening. Is that happening? Yeah, it's happening. Is there consolidation? Yes. In the same way that Barnes and Noble and Amazon kind of cannibalized the smaller retailers, you're also seeing that happen in church. And you can argue that that actually is what happened with the mega church in the 90s and the 2000s, that a lot of those little small independent churches, and you benefited from that as church planters, as we have. 50% of our growth was unchurched people over the years, and 50% was people from other churches who are like, this is better. So how do you compete with Stephen Furtick? How do you compete with Priscilla Schreier, right? It's a great question. Just be the local church. Like Mike Todd is not coming to your city, I promise you. I know Mike, he's not showing up. Nobody should be able to out-local the local church. They just shouldn't. You should be for your local community. You should be for teachers in your community. You should get to know the people. You should have a way of reaching out. And you know, at a certain level, I think above 200, pastoral care becomes a system, not a person. I think at 100, it should become a system, not a person, maybe earlier. But nobody should be able to out-local the local church. Nobody should be able to out-group your small groups. And nobody should be able to out-relationship the local church. And when you have that kind of connection, you know, we're boaters and everybody bought boats. So we've been boaters for a long time, but I don't want to compete at the boat ramp. Usually I trailer. So I called the local marinas and I made a connection this morning with a guy named Justin. And I thought, I like Justin. And he answered my questions and away we go. And I think I'm probably going to put my boat there this summer because it'll just be easier than, you know, fighting with everybody at the boat ramp and waiting for an hour to launch and things like that. But what was I looking for? I was looking for a human being I really liked. Does he have a good boat slip? Yep. Does, you know, am I going to be able to keep my boat there at a reasonable price? Yep. But I really liked him. If I didn't like him, I would have called the next person on my list until I found somebody I really liked. Because I want to know if he's going to take care of my boat when I can't. Number two, make the goal of your digital presence connection, not consumption. We can unpack this in the Q&A. I've got a whole course coming out on this in the middle of 2021, but I want to share with you just a couple of ideas. Small and personal beats large and anonymous in a lot of ways. Oh yeah, okay, I'll share this with you in a minute. I forgot where I was going with this one, but you know, you ever heard of Herman Miller? They do the Aeron chair and a lot of other designs. So I have an Aeron chair. It's really good for my back. I Instagrammed them and just said, hey, I'm so glad editing this book. I've got this Herman Miller chair. I want to show you what they said. This is when I first broke my hand. We hope your arm gets better soon. That was Herman Miller, like direct messaging me. Next time I have to buy a chair, who am I going to think of? Probably Herman Miller. Why? Because I remember that. And, you know, if you have someone on your social media, if somebody says, hey, I love your church, you know, you just that is so warm and personal. And I needed a left arm that was much higher than the right arm when I was writing so that I could actually type. And they remembered me. And look at their number of followers. They have 400,000 followers. And they don't even follow me. But they responded. Isn't that kind? You remember stuff like that. Okay. And then here's the fun I'm going to put in the course, later this year. Connect your online audience like you would your congregation. So the good news is you already have a system. If I show up as a new person in your community at your church this Sunday, if you're open, you know what's supposed to happen. I'm supposed to fill out a welcome card, meet somebody at the new here desk. Maybe you're going to lead me toward a membership class or an alpha group or a starting point group or a small group or to serve, whatever. You got steps, right? You need that for online. And this is where the frontier is going. It's called a digital engagement strategy. And this is based on online marketing. I've run an online marketing company, content company for the last 5 years. So this is what we do. This is how the little bit that people pay, 99% of what I offer is free. The 1% that funds all my staff and everything, that pays for everything else. And that's through a digital engagement strategy. So I've adopted it to church. And if you just Google digital marketing funnel, you'll see a million variations of this. But here's how I think it works in church world. Okay, over here on the left, you've got like people who are exploring you and finding you online. So you have, you know, your Facebook page, Twitter, YouTube, Instagram, Clubhouse, wherever you happen to be, it's just an explore. And they find you and they're like, oh, I like that preacher. She's amazing. Or, he really said something that spoke to my life. Most churches stop there. That's it. And you're like, whoa, our views are up. We got 1,000 views on that video or 500 views on that video. You just stop. Well, that doesn't actually build connection. And so what you need to do, you already have this for your in-person church, but you need to move then into what they call an offer. And an offer is, yeah, it's a subscribe on Facebook or YouTube, and that's great, or it's a little engagement in the chat like Herman Miller. But what you really want to capture is probably either their cell phone number or their email address, because that moves it into a personal relationship. So if you've ever shown up at careynieuwhof.com, my website, you'll see that there's lots of opportunities to join my email list. And we have 80,000 people who have signed up for my email list. Now, what that means is Seth Godin calls it permission marketing. I now have permission to talk to you. And if you don't, you just unsubscribe. People unsubscribe every day, more subscribe than unsubscribe. That's just the law of the universe. But you want to be able to connect with people so that I can send Tom an email. Hey, Tom, it's Carey from Connexus Church. Saw you visited us online and downloaded our free ebook. How can I serve you? What do you need? Let me know. I'll read every reply. Boom, boom, boom. Or if I got your cell phone number, I can give you a call. Right? So all of a sudden I got a relationship, and then you can begin to follow up just the way you would in real life. That leads after the subscription to a personal connection where you actually get to know that this isn't, you know, some ISP in Des Moines. This is Tom. This is Mindy. Okay. I got it. Now I know who these people are and we have a relationship. Then you have the part you can't control where hopefully they make a commitment or a recommitment to Christ. That's really between them and God. But now you've got them taking steps. They're in alpha. They're in whatever they happen to be in, a small group. And then eventually when they get excited about what Jesus is doing in their life, they start to share. So you're back to social, but this is really cool. They're not sharing on your account. They're sharing on their account. And they're telling their friends, this was an amazing message from Pastor so-and-so. And they're putting it on their YouTube, their Instagram, their Facebook. Now, the algorithm people like it when people share content more than when institutions share content. So that's the stuff that tends to go viral. So that's a very basic digital engagement funnel: explore, offer, connect, commit, and share. What's really cool is that the first two are rented space. The last three are relational space and connected space. So by rented space, I mean one algorithm change, and this has happened to me numerous times, and your product can, your views can drop 70% overnight. Facebook made a big algorithm change 3 years ago, and literally the number of people visiting my website plummeted by 80% overnight. Boom. Said, we're going to go with people, not organizations. And as an organization, you need to pay to show up. Instagram changes the algorithm. All of a sudden, half of your followers don't see what you do. So it's very, very risky. But when you make that offer and they accept and you connect, you then move into relational space. So I could email you 20 times a day. I wouldn't, because you'd probably call the police or, you know, have me arrested or something. But then we have a relationship. Then it's direct and it's not controlled by the algorithm. And the algorithm favors relational sharing. So when I share a sermon I really like as a human being, that tends to get more promotion. So that's the difference. If it's all about relationship, which we think it is in Christianity, make your in-person and online presence all about relationship. Because if it's about a relationship with God and a relationship with people, why not just do it that way? And churches that can pivot will be the churches that make it. So I want to share with you a free resource. It's a Pivot Ready cheat sheet. You are welcome to take it if you want. It's three keys to adapting to rapid change. This is a framework you can use with your board, et cetera. And you can text Pivot Ready to 33777. That's just the words Pivot Ready to 33777. Surprise, surprise, you have to enter your email, but hint, this is the kind of stuff you should be doing on your website. So you don't have to take that. It's just an offer. It's entirely up to you. So that's basically what I wanted to share today, and I'm happy to open it to questions, Sean and Tom. So fire away.
Yeah, Sean's got to unmute. Sean, you're still muted. Click, nope, you're still muted. Click that button again, brother.
Well, there we go.
There you go. It's all yours. Take it away.
Knowledge, yeah. Hey, well, so many good things here. I think one of the things I just want you all to know, if you didn't notice already, we are recording this time today. I just would encourage you to show this to your sessions, your leaders, because there's so much good stuff here. And we got a lot of questions, Carey, but let me just start off with this. This is from Megan Heckman. What do you think pastor training looks like in the era of micro gatherings, home church and distributed church? And what is distributed church?
Okay. Let's start with the third question, and then I want to know a little bit more about pastor training, exactly what is meant. I'm not sure I know that. But Megan, I would say for distributed church, if you look at like Dropbox or a lot of the tech companies, almost any company these days, they're going to what they call distributed teams. So I lead a 100% remote team. In other words, I have employees in Memphis and Toronto, Hamilton, Florida, Nebraska, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a synonym for a remote team is a distributed team that employees or congregations are distributed wherever they live. And more companies are becoming distributed companies. My oldest son is a software engineer. He works for a company headquartered out of Ireland and Austin, and all of them work from their homes all around the world, just a small team. So that's a distributed team, or sometimes you hear it called a remote team. A hybrid team and hybrid church is a combination of in-person and online. So prior to COVID, 90% of churches, 95% of churches were in-person churches. I think moving forward, the growing churches, about 80 to 90% of them are going to be hybrid churches, which means that the majority of people will not be in the room, and that even I might show up once a month now instead of every other week. I don't know how to write about this in a constructive way, so I haven't said a lot about it, but I've talked to the leaders I'm coaching about it. The biggest shock for me when online church hit was how easy Sunday mornings were. You know, Sunday mornings my entire life have been a 6-7 hour commitment, kind of waste Saturday night getting ready for them too, right? And then all of a sudden I couldn't go to church. I couldn't go to church, even though I was the founding pastor. If I wasn't teaching, we had a max of 10 people in the building. You know, I don't have any skills other than communication. I'm not running a camera, so it's like stay home. So I stayed home. And at first I felt guilty. It's like, should I watch this 3 or 4 times, 5 times? I don't know. And then it's like, well, once is probably enough. And then I'm like, finally it dawned on me. This is why everybody who's become a Christian in our ministry says, you know, I'd love to be there every Sunday, but it's really hard to give Sundays up. I get it. Sundays are beautiful days. And I think going back, a lot of people are going to be like, yeah, I don't know whether I want to go back to 3 or 4 hours, which creates a potential volunteer crisis. So I think you're going to have more people pivoting in and out of in-person churches. And that means you're going to have a hybrid model. So it's that combination of people in the room and people online. And then just Megan, to your question about pastoral training, what do you mean? Like, how do you coach your volunteers? How do you coach your team? And so as long as I'm not breaking rules, if you want to unmute and just clarify, that's fine.
Go ahead, Megan.
So it's moving from small groups to micro churches, and we know how to train small group leaders. How do we train pastors of micro churches? And especially if like you're doing now that I understand this remote idea, if I have 10 people who live 2 hours north of me how do I train someone there to meet with the 10 people that are watching in that same area?
It's a great question. I don't know that there's a clear answer to that, Megan. I think there will be, definitely you want to train somebody at the level of a small group leader. So you got 10 people meeting in another state who have aligned with your church. You probably want to at least have them on some kind of accountability training. And you could do that all remote, or fly them in, or, you know, have them drive in, or you drive to them, or have a trainer drive to them at some point when the pandemic's over. So you'd probably train them very much like a small group leader. I can imagine that depending on your size, more churches would have a campus past like a pastoral staff person in charge of micro gatherings. So just like you have a small groups coordinator, you might have a micro gathering. And here's what's interesting. Okay, small groups for us is a closed model. So we're still a North Point strategic partner. And the whole idea is you join a group and you stay with those people for 18 months, 12 to 18 months. So it's not an open group. I think what'll happen with the Sunday morning micro gatherings, it'll feel like a small group, except there will be an open chair. The expectation to a small group is not that you would invite your friends, right? It's like, no, this is the eight of us and we're doing life together for a period of time. But I think when the micro gatherings gather, there would be the expectation, the prayer, the hope, and the invitation that there would be new people present. So it'd be a fluid gathering, an open gathering, rather than just a gathering of these are the eight of us who get together every Tuesday night. And I think you would train those, probably you would need a pastor of equipping and a pastor of evangelism or discipleship, or eventually a pastor of micro gatherings. Just like we have campus pastors for different locations now, you would probably develop someone along the lines of small groups for micro gatherings.
Great idea. Great plan. That's great, Carey. Hey, okay. Well, of course we get to the money question.
Yeah.
Knowing that boomers are the ones who primarily fund the church, how does digital church affect the church's ability to raise support?
That's a great question. So first of all, and there's enough of us on the call that you're welcome to push back. I would encourage you to challenge that assumption. That's what everybody told me when I came into ministry, that, you know, well, you're upsetting a lot of 70-year-olds and we kind of fund the church. So I didn't have full financial disclosure for the first decade of leadership. You may not, but I would ask the treasurer or whoever is taking care of that, is that actually true? Because I learned very quickly it was not true, that it was 35 to 50-year-olds who funded the church. Because what happens when you're in your 55 plus year is your income tends to be declining, or you're retired and you're living off a fixed income. And so almost universally for the last 25 years, the number one funders of our church are the 35 to 55 year olds. Ron, I see you shaking your head. Is that true in your situation as well? Yeah. So you may be the outlier, but I think that's generally true. Now, it's interesting because they perceive that they're funding your church. They tell you that they're funding your church, but you probably need to know the actual data on that. I've had full financial disclosure for the last 15 years, so I can assure you that that is true, and I was told it was true in the first decade. So there's assumption number one. Number two, I still had to get the stakeholders to agree to sell their buildings. These were like red brick, stained glass window, as traditional a building in Presbyterian world as you could get. So how do you do that? You cast vision for the next generation. And you can say, hey, guess what? I got good news for you. We've got like in-person church forever. Like that's not going away, okay? We're not selling our buildings. We're not gonna be a totally digital church. We've got in-person gatherings. You can come all you want. However, your kids and grandkids. And the way I cast vision is your kids and grandkids aren't coming to church. And they'd be, yep, they're not. And I said, would you like to build a church that they would love to attend with me? And they're like, I actually would. Okay. Well, that means there's going to be a lot of changes. Music's going to change. You know, the preaching's going to change. The dress code's going to change. The building itself might change. But it's the why that really buys them into the what and the how. And so I would just keep focusing on why. Like, do you want to reach your kids? You want to reach your grandkids? You want to reach the next generation? You want to be open to who God has moved in our community? And if you guys are church planting, like my guess is they would probably say yes. They joined a church plant. And then you know, I'll be 56 in March. I think my job at this point is to sacrifice for those who are coming up, not to indulge my own preferences. So I hope I really hate church in 5 years, that it's changed that much, that I don't like the music, I don't like anything, And that's great. I'll help fund it. I'll support, I'll serve, I'll drive. What do you need me to do? I'll help. So I would cast vision for that. And I have no trouble telling people that. And they get it. The healthy ones get it. The unhealthy ones, they'll always be churches that are all about them, and they can go there.
Great. You look good for 56, by the way.
Well, thank you.
Hey, we're going to get a little bit to consumption versus connection. Let me ask both these questions because they tie in together. One person says, how do we prioritize digital content and connection without encouraging the consumerism consumption, as you put it, that has already played quasi-Christians for decades? And then the follow-up question to that is, what would you say are the top five differences between content that is built for connection and community versus content that is strictly for consumption?
I think some of that really plays into the core of the message. Are you calling people to die to themselves? Are you calling people to the authentic gospel? You know, and you look at people like John Piper or Matt Chandler or others who really aren't into metrics or you know, how many views they got. They're just, you know, it's Bonhoeffer. It's like you're calling someone to die to themselves. You're calling someone to discipleship. So sometimes that gets viewed a dozen times. Sometimes that gets viewed 10,000 times. But I would look at the quality of your message, the substance of your message to determine, because if your message is consumeristic, well, that's a whole other problem. That's a theological problem. Can you repeat the second question again, Sean? They were both great questions.
Yeah, they really were. What would you say are the top five differences between content that is built for connection and community versus content that is strictly for consumption?
Yeah, so you're asking me to write a blog post on the spot. Top five. Okay, here we go.
You can make it less if you want.
Yeah. One would be if they're really entertainment driven, if they're void of substance. There's an easy way, like a TikTok video. Craig Rochelle, who I follow pretty closely, he did a TikTok with his kids, you know, and he was dancing with his daughter in the living room. Well, that's great, but it's not leading anybody to Jesus. So you can get a little bit of traction that way. I was talking to Mark Sayers out of Australia, and when the pandemic started, he had a video that got a ridiculous amount of views. And he's like, there, we've made it. And then he realized that some bizarre algorithm change meant that there were people in India who were searching for a goat video who found his message instead. And so that jacked up all the views. So that stuff never lasts. It's a flash in the pan. And that's where I think your digital engagement funnel, because ultimately where that funnel needs to lead is to baptisms. Where that needs to lead is to decisions to follow Jesus. Where that needs to lead is to step. So what I would do, I'm working on this right now. I haven't got it finished, but one of the things I'm thinking about, I'm just emailing leaders I respect who do numbers, is like, if you have 100 new guests that attend your online service and self-identify, so they opt in, they give you their information, you know, what percentage of those people should end up in small groups? What percentage of those people should be baptized or have their baptism reaffirmed, depending on your particular viewpoint? What, like, you should start to understand those ratios. If you look at digital marketing, generally there's what they call a conversion thing. So you're offering a shirt that's on sale. There's a certain percentage, like 2% of the people on your email list should buy. Right? There's open rates, things like that. So what you really want to focus on is not so much the broad end of the funnel, like that's good, but like what is actually happening in terms of decisions for Jesus. And if that isn't happening, then you've got a problem either with your message, with your funnel or something. So you really got to look at the outcome you want to produce. And I think that's probably how I'd look at it. Can you use entertainment? Yeah, I think you can use a culture to reach the culture. I think if you start to sound like the culture too much and you're not, you're offering an echo of the culture, not an alternative to it, you probably strayed off the path.
Great. Hey, I know you've been talking about this the whole time, but several people asked me, okay, when you talked about starting Connexus in 2007, what would you do differently if you were just starting up today? I mean, we've got a lot of church planters here who are just getting going and might feel overwhelmed with all these great ideas. What would just be kind of some of the basic things where you would just kind of start doing differently than you would have when you started 2007?
Hands down, number one, digital is your default. You're a digital organization with physical expressions. That's the first change I would make. Digital default. So just assume that most of the people will not be in the room. Just assume that most people are going to access your ministry and your messages through the lens of a camera. And I would think of yourself as a digital organization with physical expressions. So when I was launching Connexus in 2007, me and the team, we thought and we were online from day one because we had to film because we had two locations. So we were filming from day one, we'd upload, but uploading was an afterthought. It was some kind of thing that, you know, the service programming guy did if he had time on Tuesday. It's like, put that up. Okay. Now I would start with online. I would make that your default. So for me, you know, like I hinted at, I've flown a lot of miles over the last few years. All that speaking kind of went away overnight. And with it came the income that went with speaking, right? I got to pay a staff and, you know, fill my own fridge and that kind of stuff. And so almost overnight, we pivoted to be 100% digital company. And I just said to the team long before we knew that we'd be in this for a year, let's write that off. Let's assume physical speaking never comes back. How would we behave if we were a 100% digital company? Now, it helped for us that we were an 80%, 90% digital company already in my communications company because I'm podcasting and blogging and doing that. We had online courses. But for the last year, we've just operated as a 100% digital company, and it's been amazing. We had our best year ever, hands down. And I would start with that. Secondly, I would staff for it. The way a lot of churches, including a lot of very large churches, including ours, and even up to 2,000 or 3,000 people, here's what they did. It's like online is just also duties as may be assigned to the creative person, the tech person, the production person. And that whole like website uploading thing was just something that happened and nobody thought a lot about it. Depending on your budget, like if you're solo staff, that's a totally different story. But as you begin as staff, one of the first four staff people I would hire would be someone in digital communications, that somebody who's really skilled. And if you can't get that, and I don't mean to do ageism here, but hire young. I have a lot of young staff and they're better at online than someone at my stage of life. So I'm pretty techie. I got all the devices, da, 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 da. But I don't think like a 22-year-old. 22-year-olds grew up in that. It's a very natural ecosystem for them. And I let them run that whole part of the company and they're just better at it. So I would, and if you can't hire staff in that area, look for somebody who's young, who's a digital native, Gen Z, younger millennial, who can help you in that area. That's probably the second thing I would do. The third, I would really probably start reimagining your physical gatherings. And this is an active debate. So, you know, when things are open again, when the world goes back to normal, the question is, so will the live stream just be a repeat of what's happening on Sunday morning? Will you run a whole separate online service that is shorter, snappier, less music? Like, what are you going to do? And the jury is out on that. I've talked to some really good friends who lead some larger churches and they don't know what they're going to do. We got a little bit, I'm doing an interview on this in a week or two. We have some early data in from Australia and New Zealand that have reopened. They're almost functioning normally again. And what they're discovering is that the churches that are operating business as usual, come to the show, you know, really good preaching, really good music, really good, you know, all that attractional church stuff. They're not doing very well. But churches that have been more intentional about community and more intentional about even like, okay, we're going to expand the coffee area, which sounds really trivial. Like we got rid of coffee when we opened our broadcast location 5 years ago. And I'll tell you why. We needed the seats and we just had to turn people in the lobby really quickly so that we could empty out all that number of kids, get everybody into the auditorium. You know, I think we're bringing coffee back. And I think we're probably going to open up like some of the architecture so that we can have people just connect with each other or cordon off a section of the parking lot in the good weather so that people can connect with each other. Because otherwise, what incentive do I have to go to a building when I can get a shorter experience? And this is like thinking like a consumer, right? The other thing I would be doing is I would be thinking about how to equip those micro gatherings. So I've been sitting on my back porch or upstairs on our main floor for almost a year now. And I've got neighbors on either side of me that don't go to church. And I'm not on the regular staff of the church anymore. You know what I'm thinking? don't tell me what you're doing over there in the building. Tell me what I should do here. Put some resources in my hands. Help me, give me some ideas for hosting a barbecue when it's safe for my neighbors so that I can invite them over. Do you have an introductory Bible study I can invite my unchurched friends to? It's all Christians, but last night my wife and I started with a Be the Bridge group from Latasha Morrison, if you know her, basically based on racial reconciliation. So that would be one example where I'd be very comfortable inviting some unchurched friends into that just to talk about, you know, people of color and racial justice and those kinds of things. Like, what are you gonna do to equip me in my home rather than telling me that every time I wanna serve, I gotta get in a building and give up a Sunday morning? And I think we'll become more effective leaders if we think that way. So those would be some top of mind questions I'd be asking if I was a church leader today.
Those are great thoughts. And those might be some of your next books. I don't know, Carey. Okay. And I think a couple people here are kind of just struggling with, okay, we've got this big, broad presence, but we also want to be local. And how do we keep up just being, like, as you said, the local church, reaching those people who can't, access, or people who are shut-ins, or, the list goes on and on, to serve folks whose home lives are awful or people who live alone. What would you, maybe some encouragement you would have in that regard?
One thing I would say is, if you're not already following him, follow my friend Jeff Henderson from Atlanta. He does the Four movement. Just circle, it's Jeff, J-E-F-F Henderson, Four. He did Four Gwinnett, and he leads the Four Company now. And so that's all about being for your community, being for local businesses, for local schools, for local hospitals. He has a million good ideas in that area. But I would say, see, the challenge for those of you who are starting now, and I learned all this the hard way, is, you know, pastoral care doesn't scale. Warren Bird and Carl George were right in their Breaking Church Growth Barriers book. And it saved me probably from leaving ministry early on, is as our church started to grow, you know, when you have six people, man, you have all the time in the world. Like, I was bored. And so you go visit everybody, right? It's like, I'll visit you twice. It's like, don't come around so often. And you go to the nursing homes and you see the shut-ins and you call people. And it's not that hard. It's just not that hard. And then we grew to 50 and then 100 and then 150. And then it got really hard. And then at 200, one of two things happens. Either you burn out, which is a distinct possibility. It's really interesting. I mean, I've got a book from Robin Dunbar I'm quoting in my next book. It's called How Many Friends Does One Person Need? He's an evolutionary psychologist, but he has this thing called Dunbar's number. And so my book, I'm using it personally, but it works organizationally too. He says the maximum span of care the average person has is about 150. That if you look back at medieval villages, you look at ancient villages, you look at that things happen. And I've got a diagram in the new book. It's like you can have an inner circle of 3 to 5, a close circle of 12 to 15. And then you got about 150 other people you can sort of know personally. And then beyond that, your mind just breaks down. And that's how we organize ourselves. And if you think most churches are 150 people or less, I think the average Protestant church in America is 75 people. You could say, well, why is that? We want to reach more people. Yeah, you want to reach more people. But the average human span of care is about 150. And I first encountered that idea, not from Dunbar, but from Carl George and Warren Bird, who said, that's where you need to figure out how to scale pastoral care. So I had a lot of mistakes, you know, said to the elders, we're going to form districts. And they're like, no, we're not. I'm like, okay, so much for that idea. And then, you know, we tried small groups and everything. Well, now we have a pretty sophisticated system of, I don't know, we probably have 3,000 or 4,000 people who call our church home. So it's all like networked, and we have directors. And basically, if you're in a small group or you're serving, you're going to get cared for at our church. You're going to have people show up. Again, just because it's top of mind, talking to Rick Warren yesterday, when his son Matthew committed suicide 7 years ago, and he said, I was standing on the steps of Matthew's house. And he said, the first people to come over were my small group. And he said, they just threw their arms around me. They cried with me. They came back to my house and they said, we're not leaving. He said, they slept on the kitchen floor. They slept, like, see, that scales. Even in a church the size of Saddleback, he says, I've been with that group for 20 years. And I think you need to figure out a way that scales. So, You know, have you got a group system in place? And the point I've learned in pastoral care is not that I care for everybody. I don't have the capacity to care for everybody. I can't even know everybody's name. I have no idea who attends our church. It's a surprise to me. But people aren't looking for me to care for them. They want to make sure that they're in a church where they are cared for. And if you can equip a dozen, 100, 1,000 people to care for other people, it will scale. And so what a lot of the mega churches have done is, in talking to people who lead them, is they've gone old school. They picked up the phone and called everybody in their directory, and they've divided and conquered. So you might just want to check in with people. One thing you can do, how many of you are still in lockdown? Quick show of hands. Like, can't reopen? Yep, us too. Okay. One thing you can do, even for donors, and I got this idea because, like, when the economy went crazy and fell off a cliff last March, I didn't know how my company was going to do. It was like, you know, I have a staff and payroll and all that. And I thought, well, what if all my sponsors pull out? What if course sales die, right? Like, how are we going to pay for this? So I have a guy I work with, Brad Lominick, and Brad said, well, you should get everybody, like all your clients, on a call, and you should connect with them. I'm like, really? Okay. Well, I thought they're all CEOs. They're going to be too busy to talk to me, and they don't want to hear from me. But he said, no, just connect them, share a few thoughts. And then, so I did that. About a week after the pandemic started, said, hey, we're going to do a partner call. You're all businesses. The one thing we have in common is we partner together on my platform. And had almost this many people show up to the first call, and they were dialed in and engaged. And we just started telling stories like, what's happening in your company? What's happening with your organization? What's happening in the church that you're a part of? We're still doing those calls. I've got another one on Thursday, and people love them. And we had everybody stick around. Everyone said, no, we're in this for the long haul. We're going to be there. And so I've been suggesting that very quietly to pastors, that you should do that with your top donors. You should actually, these are people who stuck with you, and just do a Zoom call. Don't give them a pitch. Don't do announcements. Just join them for 30 minutes or so and say, hey, I'm, you know, 5 Tuesday nights from now, we're going to have a 30, 45 minute Zoom call just with people who are heavily invested in the life of our church. I just want to check in with you, see how you're doing, share a few things and go. And then for 5 minutes, share something you're learning. I'm going to talk about the new scarcity with my leaders on Thursday, just one idea about how scarcity is changing. And then we're just going to open it up and do a Q&A, and they can ask me questions, they can share their learnings, and then we're done. And what that provides is connection. People are lonely. People want to know that you care. People want to see, and you're not selling them. You're just connecting with them on a human level. And so I think you got to multi-layer that. You got to scale your pastoral care. You got to be active in your community. You know, we have a British strain outbreak 20 minutes from my house. And so I called my lead pastor and I said, hey, my successor, I said to Jeff, are we doing anything there? And we're doing something there. And that makes me feel better. I said, well, let me know what you need. I'd love to be able to help. And so it's a nursing home where like 50, 60 residents have died, and everybody got infected with the UK variant. And, you know, we're going to give them an iPad. We're going to buy them some meals and that kind of thing. It's just stuff like that, like showing up and being the church in your community, that I think can make a big difference. And sometimes to scale, you have to do things that don't scale. Not all of it'll scale, but, you know, you can scale pastoral care.
Excellent. Okay, I've got two more questions here at least, and let's see if we can get them both in, and then a couple closing comments here. Just so you know, Eric Still, raise your hand because he's a big fan of yours, so we got to give that shout out.
Hi, Eric.
He's persuaded by your emphasis on online engagement. Okay, here we're going deep now. There are many, e.g. Gene Twenge, the movie Social Dilemma, who are noting some of the dehumanizing, atomistic, addictive dangers of screens and social media. What are some ways you think about doing online ministry in a way that can offset those aspects?
Oh yeah. Welcome to our regular debate, Eric. Oh man. Like, yeah, it's really hard. I watched The Social Network. I've been following Tristan Harris for a couple of years now. I'm very concerned. Actually, I think you can look at the political division that we saw in 2020, from progressive to, you know, alt-right to Trumpism, all that stuff, as fueled by the algorithm. And I would encourage you, if you haven't watched The Social Dilemma yet, you really, really should. I hope to have Tristan on my podcast this year to talk about that in some detail. I'm very, very concerned. And we've had very big, I partner pretty deeply with a company called Glue in Colorado. Scott Beck is running that. He scaled Blockbuster before he sold it to Viacom and a bunch of other things, Ancestry.com and Boston Market. So he's as embedded. And I had this conversation with the new CEO of Intel, actually Pat Gelsinger, and they are as embedded in the tech world as anybody. And those are very, very real concerns. So here's the dilemma. You either abdicate that world and you don't have a digital presence, or you play as a good actor. And we've had that existential conversation. I've had it with Scott. I've had it with Pat. I've had it with my team. And we've decided to be an actor for good on the internet. Hopefully, you know, nobody's pure. We're not always good. We don't always get it right. But like, there's some very nasty forces at work online. And one of the things I'm doing, the posts never do well, but I'm explaining how the algorithm works. I'm explaining Yuval Harari, if you've read him, Yuval Noah Harari, says one of the greatest existential threats we have as humans is human hacking. And he calls it the ability to no longer think for ourselves. So you think you're thinking for yourself because you've watched the 18th video in a row of why vaccines are evil, or why the Holocaust never happened. And you think you're thinking for yourself, but you've actually lost the ability to think independently. Your brain's been hijacked by tech. Yeah. So that is a very, very real existential threat at the human being level. It's a very real ethical debate. One of my great sadnesses right now is that the number of Christian ethicists and philosophers seem to have gone down in the last 25 years, not up. We don't have a lot of great thought leaders in that area. So being aware that it is a struggle is a really good thing. Trying to be one of the good actors on the internet. Like, I still have comments on my website. Some days I think I shouldn't. A lot of people have disabled them because of the trolls, but I'm like, no. We're trying to create a place where good, reasonable people can come together and disagree without being disagreeable, where they can think independently. And I would say, you know, on the personal level, read widely. Don't let the algorithm determine what you read next. Read broadly, read people who disagree with you. Get into that space where you can have a variety of viewpoints without getting upset or, you know, blocking people just because they don't have the same thought that you do. But it is a very, very real problem. So for now, I've decided to try to be hopefully one of the good actors on the internet, and I hope you will too. And I know how the story ends. I know good wins. I don't know how it wins, but I know good wins. I read to the end of the Bible. It's good news. So I want to try to be on that side in that moment. But yeah, it's a real fight, and I am deeply concerned.
I'm tempted to end there because Jesus wins is the best way to end. But let me just two quick things here. Okay, one person just wanted to know the name and book title about learning to think for yourself real quick.
Oh, Yuval. Yuval Harari, Harari. No, I'm going to get that wrong. Yuval Harari. If you get close, you'll find him. He wrote a book called Sapiens. It's at the end of Sapiens. And there's also a TED interview he did with Chris Anderson on the TED Talks podcast, where he talks about human hacking as well. That was probably 2 years ago.
Perfect. Hey, here's the last question on small groups. How do you multiply small groups leaders without minimizing the trust and connection that takes years to build? For instance, you can split groups creatively, somewhat regularly to scale them well, maybe lose connection and intimacy, or you can keep groups together 20 years. How have you found a way to deal with that? And that'll be our last question. And then maybe if you got any closing comments first, Carey, and then I've got a few announcements here I need to let people know about.
You bet. Yeah, it's hard. It's just hard to do. You have people who want to be together. So, you know, we've kind of, because it's weird, like I'm the founding pastor, blah, blah, blah. So we've had basically the same small group leaders for 15 years because we trust Rob and Rose. My wife does a podcast with Rob, the Smart Family podcast. So they're good friends. They're in our backyard. We're in their backyard all the time hanging out. So we've kind of kept them as a baseline, and then we rotate out different members. And so we'll have new people in. To me, a group is exciting when there's non-believing people in there. And so we'll mix it up. So one way you can do it is you can have a core that just keeps rotating around the side. The other way is you mix everything up over time, or that people come back into group after a while. So it is a total, I think, you know, the one extreme is that everybody's new all the time. You don't really go deep. The other extreme is no, it's just the eight of us and we've been together for 30 years and we become totally insider focused. So I think you got to mix it up and be creative. Having a, like we hired Christine Birch on our staff at Connexus a few years ago to do that. And she's done a great job because I think we're over 1,000 groups now. If I got that, or 1,000 people in groups, not 1,000 groups. No, not that big.
Wow.
1,000 people in groups, adults in groups, plus all the kids in groups. And so she's figured out a way to make that scale. And not, the other thing to scale, you have to drop your standards. It's really easy when you have six people, you can all fit in the same booth at lunch and y'all agree on everything. But when you get into a really big thing, it's like, yeah, not every group experience is going to be perfect, but I've preached a lot. Not every message is perfect. Not every blog post is good. Not every podcast episode is awesome. And so what you have to do to scale is you have to be willing to have minimal viable product. Like, what is your minimum viable product when it comes to small group? What's your minimum viable product? And you'll get some gems in there and you'll learn from the gems and you move on. But it is a dance.
Great. Carey, this has been so encouraging. I know we have church planters who are just, you know, right now feeling like they're out there on their own. And this just helps brings a little more to home. We're just so grateful you could be with us today. And I just want to let everyone know that we are sending to all you church planters, we're sending you Carey's book. There you go. Anything you want to see about your book, Carey?
No, I just thank you and pray for me as I write this one. So it'll be out in September. We're just getting down to final edits. But no, you know, that I wrote that book 3 years ago, because it's a lot of the stuff we didn't talk about today, the stuff that's under the waterline. You can get all this right, but life has a way of beating you up and you can grow cynical. You can get proud. You can feel empty even after success. Like, how many people are going to be enough? How many campuses are going to be enough? All that stuff. And so I look back on my life, you know, 5 decades in, and I realize, wow, there's a lot of stuff that sink leaders that we just don't talk about enough. So those are the soft issues, which I think are the real issues: character, compromise, humility, and a few tangible ones like relevance in the mix. So that's really a heart cry, just to make sure that you're doing this smiling and closer to Jesus 20 years from now than you are today. So that's what that book's about.
That's wonderful. And Carey, I think, you know, a lot of us have watched your post, your broadcast. Today, you just brought everything a little more close to home, and we're so grateful for that. And I just want to encourage everyone again, this has been recorded, so share this with your leaders. Also, if you have any thoughts for future or bringing Carey back, we'd love to talk about all those things, as well as just right now, we know that there are some of you might be going through some hard times. Our national team is here to pray for you. We're going to be reaching out to all our church planters, all our team in these next 2 weeks, every one of you. But if you've got something that we could be praying about right away, please contact us, because in order for you to do ministry in the future, we want to meet you here today and care for you. This has been a wonderful time. Carey, you know, they asked me to close in prayer, but I just kind of like to have you pray for us.
I'd love to. And I just want to say thank you for doing what you're doing. Church planting is really difficult in a pandemic. I haven't done that part yet. So, you know, you're doing it. And thank you so much for your leadership and your faithfulness. It is hard. Hang in there. You're going to make it. You're going to figure it out. And I'm just really excited to see this many church planters gather together to be supporting each other. I think this kind of support and encouragement, for me anyway, has been absolutely invaluable. So thank you for the privilege of spending a little bit of time together today. Let's pray.
Thank you.
Lord God, you're a good God. And sometimes that can be hard to see. Some days that can be hard to feel, but we know it's true. And we know that none of this caught you by surprise, that you knew. You knew us. That this dream in our hearts to plant churches was actually a dream in your heart long before it entered ours. And so I pray for the women and men on this call. You would inspire them, encourage them, build them up, that you give them the strength to keep moving, the wisdom to know when to rest, the grace, Lord, pour out your favor on these church plants. You're so merciful and you're so good. And I pray you would help everybody on this call to bring your gospel to a world that so desperately needs it. The real gospel, the real Jesus, real hope. And I pray, God, that lives would be changed as a result of what happened today and what will happen and what has happened. And that you would give favor to boards, to staff, to the people that we go back to, so that we would have the wisdom to know what to do. And that you'd also give us great courage to do it. And we pray this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord, who does win. Amen.
Amen.
That was the best part of the whole time, Carey. Yep. Thank you. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Thank you, everybody. I really appreciate
Carey.
It.
Thanks, Carey. Thanks. We know you got to run.
Spend time with you. Thank you. Thank you, Tom. Thank you, Sean. Thank you, everybody.
Take care. Rest of the crew, thanks for being with us today. Leadership team, if you would stick around for a couple minutes, we just want to make sure we kind of wrap up our time and take care of everything. But church planters, as Sean said, in the next 2 weeks, you'll be hearing from one of our team leaders just to connect and just to check in with you. And in the meantime, if you need us, please reach out. Thanks, everybody, for attending. Have a great afternoon.